will receive us.
We do not ask for your poor or your hungry.
We do not want your tired and sick.
It is your corrupt we claim.
It is your evil that will be sought by us.
With every breath, we shall hunt them down.
Each day, we will spill their blood till it rains down from the skies. Do not...
All right, shalom, shalom, brothers, sisters, Akim, Akwata. Once again, you're not under the sounds of the voice of your Ak, Tazadaq. And I'm here with my Isha, Elisheva. And so basically, the reason that I'm actually having her to do this video to actually help those of you that's actually caught up into the court known as a Jehovah Witness. And my question has been to any of you that's actually under this cult is, what exactly have you witnessed? Because the Most High lets his people know, and he lets the world know exactly who his witness are in the book of Isaiah. In the book of Isaiah, so, you know, this is actually not an attack on Jehovah Witness, but this is to encourage you, if you're caught up into the court of Jehovah Witness, to come out of the court. You know, get your children and family out of the court. So, according to the Bible, the first thing that I would actually like to show to you, according to the word of the Most High, not Charles Russell, but according to the word of the Most High, who are the witnesses of the Most High? That's the first thing that needs to be established. So I'm going to go to the book of Isaiah, the 43rd chapter, verse 10. And it reads, "Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servants whom I have chosen." So the Most High is saying that he has actually chosen a particular people. Now let's see who he was actually talking to. It's very clear who he was talking to. We go to Isaiah 43 verse 1. "But now, thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob." Who is Jacob? Jacob was the son of Isaac and Rebekah, whose name was actually changed to Israel, who actually was the progenitor of the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. Yasha Allah. "And he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee, and I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine." So the Most High has claimed the nation of Israel as his own people. And when I say the nation of Israel, I'm talking about you so-called blacks, you so-called Hispanics, and you so-called Native Americans of Negroid descent. If you're not of those people, then you're not of the nation of Israel, and you're not of the chosen people of the Most High, Yahweh, that you refer to as God. So if you're not worshiping the God of Israel, you're not worshiping God. So, you know, with that, you know, I'm going to actually go into something. MRI, go over there with that. I'm going to actually go into some scriptures. And, well, not really scriptures. Actually, I'm going to let Maisha try to save through the spirit of Yahweh Y Yahweh Shah those of you brothers and sisters that's actually caught up into this cult known as Jehovah Witness. And it's actually indeed a cult. The Israelites do not follow religion. We have a way of life that is actually described in the Bible. And you follow that way of life and you keep that way of life by keeping the Lord's statutes and commandments of the Bible. So, you know, Elishiva, you know, you being, you know, formerly a Jehovah Witness, you know, what was a thing that actually, you know, persuaded you or actually encouraged you to get involved in that in the first place? Now, were you a Baptist? Were you actually ever attending church prior to that? How did you actually get involved in this cult? I'm going to call it what it is because it's a cult. And when people get out, I understand that they have a tendency to follow people around and try to instill fear into them and try and tell them if they don't return, then they're going to have curses on them and so on and so forth. But what was it exactly that actually, you know, caused you to actually join this Jehovah Witness or wickedness cult in the first place?
Well, growing up, I have attended church before because my family was mostly, well, you can say just Christians. It was never like Baptist or Pentecost or anything like that. I attended church sometimes, but I really wasn't into like the church. I knew about God and I knew about, you know, things as far as doing things right and not trying to do so much things the wrong way. But I was introduced to the Jehovah's Witness as I got older. I attended a meeting and it started from there. You know, they would, you know, say like really nice things to you and give you books to read and magazines to read. One of the books that they would show you is a book about almost like a Bible book story kind of, but it showed you how the people in the pictures, they'll like specifically point out the people in the pictures and how they look and say, oh, they so happy. And they have the little children playing with animals and they'll ask you questions like, would you like to live here one day? You know, and of course you would say, yeah, because it looks really peaceful and everyone is smiling like they're really happy. But as I began to be more into the Jehovah's Witness organization, cult, if you want to call it that, you know, they would get you to first, before you could go out and knock on people's doors how they do now, you have to go through this little, I would say like a little test. They have you answer questions that they ask you about the Bible. Not that many, but you sit down with the person that actually have been studying with you and you go before the elders, which are the men, probably I say with at least one or two of them, and they ask you questions about, you know, the Bible, just random questions about the Bible that they expect that you should know since you've been studying with your study partner. And so after you go through that little test or whatever, and if you answer the questions correctly, then they'll say, okay, well, now you approve to go out and knock on people's doors and talk to them about the Bible. And then you have to be baptized. So whatever habits you have to give those up in order to be baptized. So I got baptized, which was very scary because I can't swim or anything. So I didn't have time to like catch my breath before they threw me back into the water. So that was a horrible experience. But that's about how I got into it.
Yeah, so I noticed that you actually said that basically they want to like ensure that you have some sort of scriptural background. Now, one of the ways that, you know, from what I know about these Jehovah Witness or this wickedness cult is that one of their methods or persuasion is that the name Jehovah is the name of God mentioned in the Bible. They use that. They say, you see, the name Jehovah is mentioned in the Bible, and, you know, we are actually witnessing him. But the real truth of that matter is that the word Jehovah is not the proper name of the Most High. And to those of you that's actually following that nonsense, I would actually encourage you to actually learn some biblical Hebrew or just look up, you know, the tetragrammaton, which is the four-letter representation of the name of the Most High. And they claim not to want to mention the Most High's name because it's actually too sacred. That's what the so-called Jews use. So they use what is known as a tetragrammaton, which is the YHWH. Now, but when you look in the Lashawam HaKadosh, when you look at the letter that they're using for Y, there is no Y, it's Yah. And the H that they use for the tetragrammaton is Ha. And then the YHW is Wah. So you have Yah-Ha-Wah. And then if you know anything about Hebrew, the last Ha sound, you drop the A and you just keep the H when the H is actually used at the end of a word. So that is how we came up with Yahweh. And this shows that those people really did know the name of the Most High. They do not want you to call on that name because that name carries a certain vibration with it. And not everyone is actually supposed to be using that name anyways. So that's one of the lies that they actually use to promote that. And furthermore, the letter J came into existence much later than, you know, what these people are actually telling you, even though that is actually mentioned in the scriptures. You know, the J didn't get around until approximately the 1600s. Now, some people say the 1400s, but the letter J, you know, as far as Jehovah, is not the name of the name of the Most High, Yahweh, nor is the V. But, you know, back to the Jehovah Witness. Now, one of the other things that you mentioned is that, you know, they sort of like teach you to be nice to people. They teach you, despite what, how many doors are slammed in your face, don't argue with people. Don't argue back. And from my perspective, I think that is like sort of like a psychology, you know, actually being used on the people, that no matter how you treat these Jehovah Witness people, that they have a meek spirit. But that's not real, because there's also another side to that. Now, did you actually go from door to door, you know, trying to actually invite people into this cult? And if so, you know, what was your experiences with that?
Well, I did go door to door to talk with people, but most of the time I felt uncomfortable because even though I knew some of the Bible, I felt like I didn't know enough to be out teaching, trying to teach people. And since I've come into the truth, I know now that it's not right for me to go out and, you know, be trying to teach men about the Bible and things like that. I mean, I can have a conversation with another Hebrew Israelite sister, you know, or young girls or little children, but not to be going out talking to men about the Bible and things like that. Whenever we would go to, like, they would give you a specific location to go to. I mean, you didn't know, like, they would drop you off. You would ride in cars and they would drop you off and you would have to be with a partner and you would walk up to the door. I mean, mind you now, you don't know what the neighborhood is like. You don't know if there are free roaming dogs or anything out here. So it's just like whatever. So the whole time I'm going to the doors, I'm very nervous. My heart is beating really fast because I don't know what to expect or what type of people are going to come to the door. So they tell you that, you know, you try to always smile and be very friendly whenever the people come in, they open their door. So mostly you try to find, like, they'll give you a brochure to use, like one of their publications that just came out, and whatever the title is on the brochure, that's what you try to use to basically start a conversation with the person. And then you go into, like, questions about the Bible and things like that. But as far as field service and things like that, I was always nervous about it. I didn't really want to do it, but they keep a track of who's doing the field service and how much time and hours you're putting into going out and talk to the people. So if you don't put in enough time, then, you know, they'll talk to you about it, like try to increase your time and, you know, things like that.
Yeah, so, you know, something else you actually have mentioned is that, you know, you're going out trying to teach men. Now, this is actually totally against the Bible. And a lot of you that's actually involved in feminism, that's actually under the sounds of our voice right now, are going to be in disagreement with this. But let's let the scripture speak for itself, because women are not to be actually teaching men, as, you know, my Isha has stated. When we go to the book of 1 Timothy, the 2nd chapter, the 11th verse, it says, "Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor usurp authority over the man, but to be in silent." So that scripture right there is confirming that the woman should actually not be out there teaching brothers. So, you know, we could go to 1 Peter 3, verse 11 also. So, you know, basically, women are not supposed to be out there teaching men. That's not the order that the Most High has actually set up. What you got right there?
Oh, and I also wanted to mention also that it didn't matter what so-called race the person was. If they were Chinese, they could have been an Edomite, African, or just any nation other than the Hebrew Israelite. It didn't matter. You would go to whoever door that would open to let you enter their home.
Right. So, you know, that's, again, you know, when you read the Bible and get understanding, you know, the Most High teaches that, you know, only the nation of Israel is actually, you know, salvation is actually only for Israel. And those other nations, in order for them to actually be saved, they're actually going to actually have to go into captivity for what they've actually done to the nation of Israel. So you're going to have to pay for what you've done, in other words. So the fear that you suffer from, you're actually definitely going to undergo, you know, those slave-like experiences that you've actually enforced upon the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. The so-called Blacks, so-called Hispanics, and so-called Native Americans of Negroid descent. What do you have there? So, you know, another thing that I wanted to ask you, as far as the Hamashiach is concerned, the one that they refer to as Jesus Christ. Now, did they teach, like the scriptures teach, according to Revelations, the first chapter, verse 13, 15, that he's a so-called black man, and in the book of Daniels again, he's mentioned as a so-called black man. Did they teach that Yahweh Shah, the one that they call Jesus Christ, was a so-called black man?
No, they never taught that. Even growing up as a child, we like my family would always have the so-called white Jesus on the wall. Jehovah's Witnesses teach. They never mention anything about how Christ looked.
Did they show an image of him then?
It was always the white, in their books and publications, it's always the so-called white Jesus.
Yeah. So although they didn't say it, they were still teaching you with imagery. Right. So if they showed an image, let me ask you this, did they ever show you a so-called black image?
No.
So then they was actually teaching you right there. The best way to teach people is with, you know, imagery and graphics, embedding that into their mind over and over again. Now, I've seen many of their Watchtower magazines, and every time that they had an image, it actually resembled this man right here. This is literally the image of the beast. This is the image of the beast mentioned in the book of Revelations, the 13th chapter, verse 4 and verse 8. And, you know, Revelations, the 13th chapter, verse 15, where it says, and he had power to give a life unto the image of the beast, which was the current world rulers, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause all that would not worship this image shall be put to death. Now, this happened in 1492 when the so-called white man came here by the name of Columbus, and all the indigenous Americans and Mexicans that did not worship this image was actually put to death. Now, this is his original image. This man is named Caesar Bozier, the second son of Pope Alexander VI of Rome. This is the image that they painted. He posed for the image of Christ after the Renaissance by Leonardo da Vinci and his cross-dressing lover, Michelangelo. So this is the image of the beast. But when we read the book of Revelations, you know, the first chapter, verse 13 through 15, we find out that he doesn't look anything like this at all. The way that he actually looks is a so-called black man with woolly hair. He more resembles this. Now, this is ancient artifacts of Hamashiach Yahawashah and his disciples. This is the image of Hamashiach Yahawashah, the one that you refer to as Jesus Christ. So that's another lie that the Jehovah Witness is actually teaching. And here, again, I have some ancient artifacts of the fake image of Yahawashah as a young boy and the real image. And then I have a fake image of him again as a so-called white man and the real image of him as a so-called black man, as a Hebrew Israelite, of which he was, because he sprang forth out of Judah, as mentioned in the book of Hebrews. So that's another lie that, you know, we actually know that Jehovah Witness are actually teaching those of you that's actually caught up into this cult. Now, you know, when you left, what was it that actually inspired you to leave this cult? And for you to actually realize that what you wasn't in, what you was in, was not the truth. That you really wasn't worshiping the God of the Bible. Was it something that occurred? What was it that caused you to want to leave that organization of Jehovah Witness?
Well, as I got older into the Jehovah's Witness cult, I started to do some research on they always tell you not to look things up on the internet about them because I guess they have things to hide. But I started to do research on the founder of the Jehovah's Witnesses, which is Charles Taz Russell. And so as I began to look up more and more information about him, I found out that he was a 33rd degree Freemason, and that His tombstone is the shape of a pyramid. So if you Google the information, you can see the YouTube video about it or look it up. But I was like, well, let me see, what are Freemasons? So then I started to do research on Freemasonry. So I was like, this is not right. These people worship the devil. And so they always teach you to associate only with Jehovah's Witnesses. I guess they want to keep you in that same mindset of people that's being brainwashed like you are, so that way you don't get suspicious of them and try to look up information about them. So That's how I discovered that this religion, so-called religious cult, was not right for me. I didn't really feel right in there being amongst those people. If you do certain things, like, you know, whatever they say that you can't do, or you going off on things, they'll shun you. They won't talk to you. Just say, for instance, if one of your children, like if you have a daughter or something, and she, you know, go out and get pregnant or something like that, well, they'll shun her. She'll have to sit in the back of the kingdom hall and no one could talk to her, which I think that's very harsh. You know, it could be a lot of things, but as far as me getting out, one day when I was attending one of their meetings, I saw on stage they have this chair that have fabric on it, which like patterns and things like that. So when I was looking up the information about Freemasonry and things like that, I saw the image of the Baphomet, which you can Google that to see the picture of it also. It's like a goat ram head type thing or whatever. So a ram-headed goat. And I was like, this is what the image of the Baphomet is. So one day I was attending one of their Kingdom Hall meetings, and something just had me focus on the chair that was on stage. And as I was looking at the image in the chair on stage, I could see that same Baphomet head image on a pattern that was on stage. And I tried to point this out to, you know, a couple of the people that were sitting by me. But, you know, they just shrugged it off like, you know, what is she talking about? This, you know, which I already mentioned to them before about the information that I had looked up anyway. But they just brushed it off like I was crazy or whatever. But that's what really made me stop going. I just felt like that it wasn't right for me, and that it was a cult. And the things that they try to do to brainwash you, to keep you in there. And once I stopped going, I kept receiving phone calls from the elder, which are the men, the elder men, one in particular. I won't give out their name, but they were calling my phone. I seen them come drive past my house a couple of times before. So I wrote them a letter the first time for them to leave me alone, because I didn't want to be involved in their religious brainwashing cult anymore. So, you know, I wrote the letter to them, which I mailed it to them. So I thought that would stop them, but it didn't. I still received phone calls. I still kept having people come by my house. Even some of the family that was in the religion came by my house to try to talk me back into it. And I said I wasn't going to do it. So I had to write a second letter. And in the second letter, I told them that if they continued to call me or come by my house and harass me, then I was going to go and press charges, because I felt like that, you know, I wasn't safe now because they knew where I lived. So that's how I got out.
So when you say harass you, what exactly do you feel that they was doing to actually harass you?
They were calling my phone, which I would hang up, and I wouldn't return their phone calls. And I would see them on occasion come past my house, like drive by my house to see if I was home.
Right. So now, as far as the Jehovah Witness, did they actually have any women inside of their I guess watchtowers, or whatever you actually refer to those places as? Did they have any women preachers or teachers or anything like that? Or was there anything where women actually teaching men or anything like that?
As far as like Bible reading and things like that, they would always have the men or like the young boys come up and do things like that. But they would give women roles as to do like scenarios where you pretend like you're the person that's going to the house to preach. And then the other person, it could be a man or a woman sitting there, and they would be the so-called householder, the person house that you're going to. So they would have little scenarios set up like that. But it didn't matter who you would, the other person would be that's sitting in the chair. It could be a man or a woman.
So basically, they had you guys pretty much role play, you know, certain tactics that you was actually going to use on people out in society when you would actually go door to door. You know, I would actually often see him in, you know, in the subway, still see him in the subway in New York. You could find him, you know, at, by the shuttle train, 42nd. Sometimes they'd be set up in the subway, and they try and seem so modest. But, you know, and lots of times, the vast majority of times, you know, I would actually have women come up to me and try and teach me until they discovered that I knew the Bible and that I was an Israelite. Then they wanted to leave. Now, to all you women out there that's doing that, hear the words of the Most High. This is what the Most High has to say about that. If any of you, and this is not just for Jehovah Witness, this is for Seventh-day Adventists, this is for Pentecost, any of you that's out there that's teaching in these churches and you're a woman, hear the word of the Most High. 1 Corinthians, the 14th chapter, verse 34, it says, let your women keep silent in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded. So it is a commandment for the woman not to teach in the congregation where there's men, to be under obedience, as also saith the law. So this is law. So if you're doing this, guess what? Your Jehovah Witness congregation, have you breaking the law? Your Seventh-day Adventist congregation, have you breaking the law? Your Pentecost, have you breaking the law? Your Church of Latter-day Saints, have you breaking the law? So I'm going to ask you, now that you know the truth, who are you going to obey? Are you going to obey the Most High, Yahweh? Or are you going to obey man? Because man-made laws have made you laws. So, you know, after all of the shunning and so on and so forth, how was you actually ever able to get them to stop? You know, did they tell you anything bad would happen to you by you actually leaving their congregation? Did they, you know, say that, you know, your life would become miserable or anything like that? You know, I'm sure some listeners out there don't want to know, because some of you that's watching this video right now, many of you that's watching this video right now, you're caught up into that cult of Jehovah Witness and you want to get out, but you're afraid. You're afraid because they've actually indoctrinated fear into your mind, but you need to gird up your loins like a man and a woman and leave that cult and come to the truth. So was there anything that they told you that may have actually prevented you from leaving earlier than you left?
What they told me, well, some of the family said that I would be destroyed, because if you, once you leave the Jehovah's Witness organization, cult.
Hold on a second. When you say family, what do you mean? You're considering them as your family or your immediate family, like a mother, so on and so forth?
No, some of my family members that were in that Jehovah's Witness thing, they would say that if you leave the Jehovah's Witness organization, you'll be destroyed, because if you're not a Jehovah's Witness, then you'll be destroyed anyway. And if you...
So basically, if you're not a Jehovah Witness, there is no salvation for you, is what you're saying. Is that what they taught?
Right, that's what they taught. They taught that only the Jehovah's Witnesses will be one of the 144,000 that go to heaven, whether it be man, woman, whatever. That's what they taught.
All right. Now, did they give you a biblical scripture to support that? That only Jehovah Witness would actually be saved? Because we've actually already established from the inception of this conversation or this lecture exactly who the witnesses of the Most High is. Did they actually ever give you a biblical scripture showing you that only Jehovah Witness would actually be saved, which meaning actually get salvation, or is it something they just told you?
No, it was just something that was said, but I was never shown like the actual scripture that says Jehovah's Witnesses are the only ones that will be one of the 144,000.
Right, so basically, you know, it seems like a lot of hearsays and mind play to me. Now, you know, when we read the book of Isaiah 45 and 17, it tells you that Israel will be saved. When we read the book of Isaiah, you know, the 14th chapter, again, it tells us that Israel will be saved. You know, again, I go to the book of John, the third chapter, the 23rd verse, to prove all things. Let's see who salvation is truly for. Ye worship, ye know not what. Now, what's going on here? If you know the story, this is Hamashiach Yahawashah. He's talking to a Samaritan woman who actually went to draw water from the well. Now, when we go down to the 23rd verse, I'm not going to go through all of this. You can read the story yourself if you want to read it. When we get down to the 23rd verse, John 3, verse 23, I mean 22. Let's start at the 22nd verse. It says, ye worship, ye know not what. It means these other people, like Jehovah Witness, like Seventh-day Adventists, like Baptists, do not know what they are worshiping. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, meaning Hamashiach Yahawashah and the Israelites, for salvation is of the Jews, meaning for the Jews, meaning the nation of Israel, meaning the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. Now, did you ever read a scripture like that to these Jehovah Witness when they tell you, when they actually told you that if you was not a Jehovah Witness, you would not have salvation, when the Bible itself is actually reading right here in John 3:22 that salvation is for the Jews, meaning the nation of Israel?
No, I wasn't told anything like that. I was never told that I was a Hebrew Israelite. I basically just went off whatever they was telling us, you know. You didn't really ask a lot of questions as far as what you were being taught. So you just basically went off whatever they told you.
So, I mean, simply because someone told you something, you basically just believed it.
Right. I didn't have my own understanding of what I was, you know, reading. But I just basically went off what they told me.
Again, you know, for a lot of you that's out here, just caught up into the court of Jehovah Witness, I'm going to read another scripture about who salvation is for. Book of Isaiah, the 45th chapter, verse 17. But Israel, not Jehovah Witness, Yasha Allah, but Israel, not the Baptists, not the Seventh-day Adventists, but Israel shall be saved in the Lord, in Yahawashah, with an everlasting salvation, meaning forever. Ye shall not be ashamed nor confounded world without end. So the world that God so loved in the book of John 3:16 is talking about the world of Israel. Because when the Hamashiach Yahawashah returns for his second coming, only the Israelites are going to be saved. That's indisputable. It's irrefutable. It's in the Bible again and again. Now, let me ask you this. Did the, they may not have said this to you, but, you know, there's a lot of so-called Christian organizations out there teach that the Most High first made a covenant with Israel, but he later, extended that into the entire world, and now all nations can actually be saved, because if you believe in Hamashiach Yahawashah, they call Jesus Christ, you get salvation through him. Did they teach anything like that?
Well, as far as teaching, they did basically teach that all nations can be saved, because in their Jehovah's Witness organizations, they have all nations in there. and they have certain, just say for instance, if you are Chinese, they have a Chinese meeting time that you can come if you're Chinese and you only speak Chinese. They have times for that. And then just say if you happen to be a African, but not of a Hebrew Israelite, but they have meeting times for you also if you don't speak English. So, yeah, it basically doesn't matter to the Jehovah's Witnesses because they do teach that all nations can be saved. But only if you are a Jehovah's Witness, because if you're not, then they'll teach you that you will be destroyed.
And what do you have to do to be a Jehovah's Witness?
You have to have them come into your home and give Bible studies. You have to have a Bible study partner, someone that has been in the Jehovah's Witness organization for a while or years or whatever. And they'll come to your home at whatever time you pick. They'll come to your home and have Bible study with you, whatever time is available for you. They'll come over and talk, maybe stay an hour or two or so like that. You know, once you start to learn more and more about whatever they're teaching you, because they're not really teaching you what the Bible says. And they have their own Bible. They don't have the King James Bible. It's their own. It's called the New Translation Bible. So the words are changed in the Bible. So it's basically whatever they want you to know, that that's what you're being taught. I always wondered why their Bible was different. I never really questioned them, but each time you question them about anything, they always have a good reason why this or that. But I just never really questioned it. I just thought that, you know, if they're teaching you all these nice and happy good things, then it should be right. It should be okay. But if you don't really have your own mind to, like, think for yourself, then you'll just continue to go along with whatever they're telling you.
So, I mean, basically, it sounds like you just pretty much followed this blindly because, you know, if they weren't really showing you this stuff in the Bible, then what was it that actually made you follow it?
What drew me into that was some of the pictures that they were showing in the book about how the earth was going to be renewed and there wasn't going to be any more like bad people here that you know, that the bad people are going to be destroyed. And if you continue to not be a Jehovah's Witness, then you'll be destroyed also. It was almost like a intimidation, like kind of fear, like that if you don't become one or follow them, then you're going to be destroyed. So I'm thinking in my mind, in my head, well, oh, I don't want to be destroyed. So I guess I better be a Jehovah's Witness. No, there were no laws kept. The only thing that they celebrate or were allowed to celebrate was the Jesus' death, well, Yahweh Shai's death, and a baby shower. Those were the only two things that you could celebrate. Like, they call it they didn't say the Passover, really. They called it something else. The memorial, that's what they called it. Jesus Memorial, that's what it was called.
So, you didn't keep any high holy days as mentioned in the book of Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, if I'm understanding you correctly.
No, there were no laws kept. The high holy days, we did not keep any of those.
All right, so again, as you see, if you're into any type of Christian ideology like Jehovah Witness, Seventh-day Adventists, Baptist, Pentecost, Church of Jesus Christ and the Latter-day Saints, if you're not keeping these laws in these high holy days, then you're not following the Bible. And don't say that the laws was done away with, because that conflicts with the book of Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse 17. You know, Hamashiach came to fulfill the law, and he's still carrying that out. So we're still under the law. And grace does not relieve you of the law. The only law that you're actually relieved from under grace is the law of animal sacrifice, because Hamashiach Yahweh Shah was the ultimate sacrifice. So you're not saved because you're under grace. You have to keep these laws. So in closing, is there anything that you would actually like to say to any of the listeners out there that may be actually caught up into the Jehovah Witness, that's afraid to get out? Is there anything that you actually would like to say to those people that's caught up into that cult?
Well, I would like to say that if it doesn't feel right, then it's probably not right. If you feel like that, if they don't want you to look up things about them, then they're probably hiding something. So I would do my own research. You don't have to let any of those other members know that you looking up information, but go online and look up information about them, because the things that they do and the things that they teach is not right. And once you decide to get out, you may have to write letters like I did for them to leave you alone. But it is definitely not the truth. They don't teach you the truth. They don't teach you that Yahweh Shah is a so-called black man. They don't teach you that. So I would definitely get out now while you still can.
So, for all of you that believe that Jehovah Witness is where you would actually seek salvation, I would turn you to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelations, the 21st chapter, verse 12. And it reads, "And had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates." Why 12 gates? Because it's symbolic to the 12 tribes of Israel. "And at the gates were 12 angels, and the names written thereon are the names of the 12 tribes of Israel, the children of Israel." So my question, if Jehovah Witness is the only place you could get salvation, why is the name Jehovah Witness not written on the 12 gates? Why is it the names of the 12 tribes of Israel? Because it is a cult, because it is a lie, and if you don't get out, you will be condemned. If you do not leave this cult and turn yourself over to an Israelite congregation, you will not enter the kingdom of the Most High. Yahweh shall warn you that many will come in my name saying that they're Christ. What he meant by that is all of you caught up into the philosophy of Christianity, because Christians, the people that's referring to themselves as Christians, these churches are not teaching the truth. And who comes in Christ's name? Christians. Christianity, Christ. Christ, Christians. And many of these men has declared themselves as the Christ. And they have deceived many. And the scripture says, if it was possible, they would deceive the very elect. So yeah, I'm continuing on, with the Jehovah Witness cult. Exposing a cult. Some of the other things that I've done some research on, what the Jehovah Witness won't tell you. And this conflicts with many of you Christians, what you believe. And we Israelites don't necessarily believe all of these things that I'm going to, expose, that this Jehovah Witness cult actually have a tendency not to tell its participants, or its subjects, should I say. Now, one of the things that they believe that they do not usually tell you is that all true Christian churches are of the devil. The Jehovah Witness do not tell you that. They believe that you Baptists, all of you, are of the devil. Another thing that they believe is that the one that you refer to as Jesus Christ, whose proper name is Yahweh Shah, or you could refer to him as Yeshua in modern Hebrew, they don't necessarily believe in the Trinity as many of you Christians do. Now, I don't believe in a Trinity either, but my point is that the Jehovah Witness don't believe in that, and they're not telling you that. You'll actually have to find that out on your own. They literally believe that Yahweh Shah is the Archangel Michael, the first being that they claim that Yahweh, the Most High, that you refer to as God, created. Now, were you aware of any of that?
No.
So, I mean, again, this is what they do not tell their members, that some people that's actually left the Jehovah Witness cult found this out later, or they found it out from, you know, being actually introduced to their leadership positions, and they discovered that they don't really believe these things. You know, again, they don't believe in the Trinity like many of you other Christians, which, you know, they are correct in doing so. They believe that the one that they refer to as Jesus actually died on a stake rather than on a cross. Now, did they tell you that?
Yeah, I was made aware of that, but they always said a stake and not a cross.
So when they say stake, what exactly did they mean? Can you elaborate on that for these people that may be new to Jehovah Witness, or these people that may be considering leaving but just have not been courageous enough to leave?
I mean, just basically two pieces of wood that makes a stake, and so they don't consider that a cross.
Now, one of the other things, and you know, that makes them anti-Christ, you know, because if you don't believe in HaMashiach Yahweh Shah, you're considered to be anti-Christ, is they do not believe that HaMashiach Yahweh Shah, the one that you refer to as Jesus Christ, was risen from the dead. Now, did they tell you that? That they do not believe that Christ rose in bodily form from the dead?
No, I was never told that. I know at the memorial, which they call it Christ, some people call it the Passover, but they call it Jesus Memorial. Some of the partakers of that service, be it man or woman, would actually eat the bread and drink the wine because they say that they are anointed, which I thought that was kind of bizarre, because anybody can just say that, well, I feel like I'm anointed. So I don't understand where that comes in.
So they also teach that, well, the higher members are taught this, but not you, Jehovah Witness, that's in his court on a lower level. They do not teach you that they believe that only the 144,000 Jehovah Witness will go to heaven. Only the 144,000 Jehovah Witness. If you're not Jehovah Witness, you will not go to heaven. The rest will live forever in paradise on earth. That's the rest of you witnesses. But only the 144,000 Jehovah Witness will go to heaven, never meeting the person that we refer to as Yahweh Shah. They say you would never meet him.
Now, when they say the ones that will live on earth in paradise, they're talking about the ones that come out of the Great Tribulation.
And what is the Great Tribulation?
From my understanding, it's supposed to be a battle between the good and the bad.
Well, what they're mistranslating is that the Most High is going to raise HaMashiach Yahweh Shah up along with his angels and the righteous of Israel. And that's going to be the battle of Armageddon. What they're referring to as a great tribulation is the battle of Armageddon, where the nations actually go to war in the valley of Jehoshaphat. So one of the other things that they believe that they don't teach other members, well, they taught you because you mentioned it, that if you're not a Jehovah Witness, if you're not into that cult, then you cannot have salvation. Now, I don't see that anywhere in the scriptures, because I read in the scriptures time and again that salvation is only for the Israelites. So it seems as though they've been actually, you know, misconstruing the scriptures and having you believe just about anything. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go into the book of Isaiah, the 14th chapter. And we're going to, again, see who salvation is for. Because this cult, Jehovah Witness, says that if you are not a Jehovah Witness, then you cannot have salvation, meaning you will not be saved. And from what I'm understanding, HaMashiach Yahawashah does not bring about your salvation. What actually brings about your salvation is only you being a Jehovah Witness. Now, the book of Isaiah, the 14th chapter, verse 1. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob. Who was Jacob? Jacob was the second son of Isaac and Rebekah, whose name was actually changed to Israel, who became the father of the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel, the only people that's actually going to be saved until the nations that actually put the nation of Israel in captivity go into captivity, according to the Bible. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel. He's not choosing the Jehovah Witness, as you've been actually lied to all of you Jehovah Witness that's actually been told that you're the chosen. You're not even reading from the Bible of the Most High. You're reading a Bible that was actually written by that court. So he's not choosing the Baptists. He's not choosing the Seventh-day Adventists. He's not choosing the Pentecost. He's not choosing the Church of the Latter-day Saints. He's only choosing Israel and will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land. Now, there's a certain group of people going around, you know, claiming themselves to be Jews, and I guess meaning Israelites. And in 1948, when Israel actually became a forged state with the assistance of America, it was mandated to be a state. Supposedly, the Jews was actually returning to their land. But as we read on, we discover that this prophecy has not been fulfilled, because it says, set them in their own land, and the strangers shall be joined with them, meaning people that don't belong there, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob. Every time you other nations pick up this Bible, you're cleaving to the house of Jacob, because the Bible is actually only given to Israel as written in the book of Psalms 147, 19 and 20. And the people shall take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for servants and handmaid, slave men and slave women. And they shall take them captives who captives they were. Now, we know this is not talking about the convert Khazarian fake Jews, because they was never in bondage to us. They was never in bondage to any man. So the prophecy is not fulfilled. Why? Because the real Jews, the real Hebrew Israelites, has not returned to their own land. But according to the scripture, salvation is only for Israel, not the whole world. Now, what are we reading? Bible prophecy. This is not something that's made up. You can read it for yourself. Now, another thing that Jehovah Witness do not teach its lower members is that you are not allowed to question the Watchtower leadership or teaching. Do you know anything about that?
Well, I know that you weren't allowed to go like on YouTube and watch information or pull up information about the organization, because I guess they have things to hide, or they didn't want you to know what they was up to.
Now, another thing that the Jehovah Witness do not teach its members, that you must read the Watchtower magazine. And if you do not read the Watchtower magazine, you will fall back into darkness and you will begin to follow the regular forms of Christianity.
Well, I know that when they give us, because we all get free publications, I mean, they would, you would have to give like donations, you know, whenever you're able to, but they, with the Watchtower, we had to read that, and then when at the next meeting, they would ask questions about it, and, you know, you sit in the audience or whatever, and then they have the elder person on stage, like, asking questions about the Watchtower from what you read that former night.
Now, another thing that they don't tell their members is that the Jehovah Witness has actually predicted or prophesied the end of the world 5 different times. And guess what? They've been wrong every single time. So why would you follow a court that has claimed the world is actually going to end on 5 different occasions, having you, you know, I'm preparing for the end of the world, when they have no clue when the world was going to end? Because Hamashiach Yahweh Shah said, of the hour and time knoweth no man. Am I right? Go in the room with that. Go in the back with that. Go ahead. What about the end of the world? What did they tell you about that? Go in the room with that.
Well, they always say that it's right around the corner, so just be prepared. And with the 5 dates or years that was stated, I had to find that out on my own by watching a YouTube video.
Now, they've also changed a major Watchtower prediction that the end of the world would actually come before the generation of witnesses born in 1914 died. But it didn't happen. So, I mean, did you know this before you joined this cult?
No, I didn't know any of that.
Now, another thing is that they are actually also to encourage to visit homes for at least 10 hours per month. Are you aware of that?
Yeah, I'm aware of the
distributing Watchtower material.
Right, the distribution of the Watchtowers. You know, every now and then you can sneak in to say, you know, that they accept donations or whatever, so they continue the preaching work. That's what they call it. Also, they keep a track of your field service. That's what they call it when you go out and knock on people's doors. They keep a track of that, those hours. So if they feel like you're not putting in enough hours, then they encourage you to put in more hours.
Now, also, what they do is they use their own translations of the Bible, which is actually mistranslating the Bible, fulfilling Bible prophecy again. So when we go into the King James 16:11, or we read from the Apocrypha, and by the way, the Apocrypha means hidden books that was actually taken out the Bible by the Roman Canaan Society. But if you get a King James 16:11, the Apocrypha is still in the Bible. When we read the book of 2nd Esdras, the 5th chapter, verse 1, it says, "Nevertheless, as concerning the tokens, behold, the days come that they that dwell upon the earth shall be taken in great number." What does that mean? What it's talking about here is not talking about no damn rapture. What it's talking about is talking about many of you would actually be taken by these cults like Jehovah Witness, like Seventh-day Adventists, like Baptists, like Pentecost, like, you know, the Church of the Latter-day Saints in great number. You would be taken by these false philosophies. You would be taken by their misinterpretations of the Holy Scriptures. So you're actually being taken in great numbers. So you must, it is a must that you come out of these cults. And the scripture reads on and says, "And the way of truth shall be hidden." So you haven't known the truth until the Most High has actually written up Israelites to actually teach you the truth. "And the land shall be barren in faith." So many of you don't even have faith in Hamashiach Yahweh Shah. So you being a former member of the Jehovah Witness, am I making this up? Did not the Jehovah Witness have their own translation of the Bible?
Yes, they do. It's a little black Bible, and on the front of the Bible, it says New Translation.
Okay, have you actually ever read from that thing?
I have, and since I have come into the truth and seen the actual real King James Bible, I can remember that in that New Translation Bible that the words are changed.
Now, one of the other things that they won't tell you when you join, like you mentioned earlier, is they're very well known to disown, to shun, and to ignore any friends or family members that may leave that cult. They discourage you also getting a higher education. You being a member of the court, could you speak to that?
Well, they don't encourage you to go to college. They say since Armageddon or the end of the world, as they say, is right around the corner, your main focus should be going out preaching to the other nations. I know that a couple of the some of the members that were there before, they would get them to go on assignments like husband and wife, and it could be to another country to go out and preach to other people. But they definitely don't encourage you to go to college. They prefer you maybe to just, if you have a job, just keep working at your job. Don't go to school.
Now, they also teach that you're not allowed to join the military or anything of that nature. Is that correct? Are you aware of that?
Yes, they don't allow you to do that also.
All right. So, you know, knowing all of this, the Jehovah Witness don't tell you much of this, and they teach you a lot of these lies, but they, you know, overall, they're still telling you that before you become a Jehovah Witness, the Bible standards are clearly explained to you, and they are outright lying to you. And if you cannot see that they're lying to you, then you're lost. You're lost. So, you know, knowing all of this, what would you say to someone that's actually still caught up into the cult of Jehovah Witness and, you know, are unable to get out? And also, you know, are they allowed to have strong drinks? Are there women actually required to cover themselves properly, and so on and so forth?
Well, to members now, it's best if you do, you know, do your own research of the Jehovah's Witness cult. Look up things about them, because what they're doing is not right. They're leading you astray. Yes, they can drink. They tell you that you don't supposed to drink a lot of alcohol, but I've seen plenty of them drink more than what they should. And no, they don't teach you about dressing modest, because a lot of the women that, when I would go to the Kingdom Hall book studies or whatever, a lot of the women in there would have real tight skirts and dresses on. Most of them will have their cleavage out. So they don't teach you about dressing modest and not wearing pants, things like that.
Yeah, typical Christian jargon. So, you know, in conclusion, you know, all of you that's caught up into that cult, hear the words of the Most High. Book of John, 16th chapter, verse 1. These things have I spoken unto you, that ye should not be offended, that you may not stumble, that they shall put you out of the synagogue. Yeah, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth a good service. So any of us that's coming and speaking the truth about Hamashiach, Yahweh Shah, are talking about, you know, we are the true Israelites, the true chosen people of the Most High. Initially, you thought we was bugged out of our mind, and many of you still want to accept it, and you want to put us to death. But you're going to find out that there's only one truth, one faith, one baptism, and one Lord. And these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father nor me. So the reason that the Jehovah Witness and all of these other forms of Christianity is doing this is because they don't truly know the Most High, Yahweh, and they do not know Yahweh Shah. As I stated earlier, if you're not worshiping the God of Israel, Yahweh, you're not worshiping God. So, you know, I'm going to bring this to a close. I thank you for listening. Hopefully, you know, you take this vibration, you know, and it will actually get you up from out of the cult of Jehovah Witness. Because if you remain in the cult of Jehovah Wickedness, you will not enter the kingdom of the Most High. You will be put to death for idolatry, because you are worshiping an idol. You're not worshiping the God of Israel. Come out of the court now. Yahweh Ba'ashem, Yahweh Shabarakatha, Shalom Yasha'Allah. Get out, you will be condemned. If you do not leave this cult and turn yourself over to an Israelite congregation, you will not enter the kingdom of the Most High. Yahweh shall warn you that many will come in my name saying that they're Christ. What he meant by that is all of you caught up into the philosophy of Christianity, because Christians, the people that's referring to themselves as Christians, these churches are not teaching the truth. And who comes in Christ's name? Christians. Christianity, Christ. Christ, Christians. And many of these men has declared themselves as the Christ. And they have deceived many. And the scripture says, if it was possible, they would deceive the very elect. But it's not possible. It's not possible. So with that, if you're caught up into the cult of false philosophy of Jehovah Witness, I encourage you to get out as quickly as possible and join an Israelite congregation. You could actually visit the website, www.lordsheepisrael.org. You could actually also tune in on YouTube to the Undaunted National. Like this video, share it with as many Jehovah Witness that you know possible. Do not be deceived. Hamashiach is not mocked. I'm Tazadaq. I'm signing off. I'm going to say Shalom Yasha Allah.